the 17 children that lost and were lost 2 weeks ago, and also to commemorate their memories. So, Dr. Seas, can you light the candles for us, please? There's one candle.
Scott, can you turn it in?
Will help us remember why we're here.
I was hoping to light the candles.
Oh, okay, whoever would like to. Absolutely. If you want to do half of them, I'll do the other.
You start.
Okay. Now, if we could all just bow our heads and for the next moment or so, think about what's been happening in our society and our concerns for our children and the memories of the 17 and the many that we've lost. The definition of the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. Almost daily, we hear reports of gun violence in our schools, from elementary school until college. We see gun violence affecting people in their churches through across all faiths. We see domestic violence. We see children injured by guns. We find violence in movie theaters, nightclubs, and music festivals. And some people in this audience may not remember, but 25 years ago, we actually had a mass shooting here in Fayetteville, yes, at Luigi's Restaurant. Yes. And a lone gunman came in with rifles and killed 4 people and severely injured 6 others, right here in town. As a general surgeon, I've spent 25 years of my life as a trauma surgeon. I trained at Detroit Receiving Hospital, which is a level 1 trauma center, the Knife and Gun Club at Detroit, not exactly military level, but still a lot of people being injured. And then I came to Fayetteville, and we still have similar problems, even 30 years later from when I came here. I've had firsthand experience seeing the bodily harm that occurs with gunshot wounds. I've seen the family grief that follows when we have to tell somebody that their loved one has been shot, or worst scenario, that we've lost their loved one because there was nothing humanly possible to help them survive. I've seen the long-term costs to society because people's lives are changed forever once they have had a gunshot wound. So, gun violence is an American society problem. Now, to try to get a better idea of who we are, because I've met some people in the audience and I haven't met everybody yet, I'd like to just kind of take a quick little informal survey of who we are, our levels of experience, and our expertise. And don't worry, I'm not going to make anybody uncomfortable or single you out. Okay, but let's start with education. Do we have any teachers in the audience? I actually taught high school in Detroit for a year before I went to medical school. Excellent. Do we have any students? Not parents, I would say. Okay, excellent. Do we have other people that work in schools, like cafeteria workers and... Good, excellent. Okay. And because we have people that are in the offices and all. Okay. How about military? Do we have any active duty today? Okay, we've got some veterans in the audience, I know, both male and female. How about military spouses? Okay, good. How about Army brats? Okay. How about local law enforcement? I know we do have a deputy out in front. How about spouses of law enforcement? My husband is a retired cop. Legal community. Any judges in the audience? Any attorneys? How about church? that are employed in both small businesses and large businesses that deal with the public? Pretty much everybody. And how about the medical field? We have our first responders, the emergency technicians, the paramedics, the firefighters. We have nurses and PAs, and then we have physicians, and there's several physicians here. How many of us are mothers? Okay. And how many of us are concerned citizens? Okay. All right. The Serenity Prayer says, God, please give me the serenity to accept what I cannot change, the courage to change what I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. So, God, grant me the serenity to accept what I cannot change. I cannot change somebody else's beliefs. I cannot change somebody else's religion or opinions. I can change my own, but I cannot change theirs. We can't change the NRA. The founding fathers designed our Constitution, amendments, and Bill of Rights to stabilize our nation. So it's not easy to change those. It can be done, but it's very, very difficult. Federal laws enacted by our Congress, very slow process. Matter of fact, it's kind of like trying to do an emergency U-turn with an ocean liner. It takes forever. One of the things we can't prevent is mental illness, but we can identify it and we can treat it. And we have to be aware, we have to accept the fact that even bodyguards and the Secret Service could not prevent President Kennedy, President Reagan, and Martin Luther King from being touched by gun violence. God, grant me the courage to change what we can. And that's the ability for us to come together with a common cause and a vision and with common goals. We can change local and state laws. We can vote at all levels of government, from localized government to federal government. We can let our elected representatives know how we feel and what we want. They need to know if we can vote them in, we can vote them out. We can insist that our school boards, both local and state, make better decisions to protect our children. God grant me the wisdom to know the difference. This starts with education. The first step is self-education. We need to learn the issues. We need to learn the facts. We need to know the history, and we need to come up with solutions. Then the next step is community education. When we are better educated, we can spread the information to our community. Communication is the key. Communication is the bridge between confusion and chaos and clarity and purpose. So this is a call to action. We need to come together as mothers and concerned citizens. We need to start the conversations. We need to listen and learn from each other. We need to seek and to implement common sense, reasonable, workable, and nonpartisan solutions. We need to protect our children in this current environment of gun violence. And in the words of Mahatma Gandhi, we need to be the change we want to see in the world. Bring up a few people that were at our meeting over about 10 days ago. Dr. Navita Z's, well, to spark the group coming together.
afternoon on a busy Saturday. I know there's a lot of other places and things you could be doing, so thank you for coming and being here. So very quickly, the reason why I decided to be a part of this group, my children have already graduated from Cumberland County Schools. They're going on about their lives, but you know, I feel like I'm a mother to everybody's children because it's our community. So what I hope to bring to this group is to be more than just a meeting. I'm really about action. How will we impact our lawmakers? If you look at what's going on in Florida, their General Assembly is already moving to enact laws that really support semi-automatic weapons. I would expect that our legislature will make similar sorts of efforts. Now, many of you know that I work with Democracy North Carolina, nonpartisan organization, so that means I'm an organizer. How do we impact the people that make the laws? Do we lobby them? Do we go and knock on their doors in the General Assembly? Yes. Do we impact them via social media? Do we have a letter writing campaign? What is it that we want? This group has got to be more than just us meeting to feel good and talk about it. I hope you all come back and let's figure out how to change this. We have two legislators right here, and hopefully they will speak about the impact that we can have. This General Assembly, you know, has done some things that I'm not happy about, whether it's voter ID law, whether it's illegal gerrymandering. So I'm not really hopeful that they will act in a way that I would hope that protects our children. Semi-automatic and automatic weapons have no place in our neighborhoods. I'm an Air Force veteran. I've fired an M16, and some of you all have an M60, and I'm telling you, the damage that it does has no place on our streets. So that's what I hope to bring to this. Sylvia, you and I have worked on things before. We are really about getting it done. So if you join us, I promise you that I will work to make sure that this is just not a meet-to-meet. And even we have a city council representative here, Councilwoman Tisha Waddell. Even though they cannot impact state laws, but they're a part of their delegation. So if we go to our city council and our mayor and say, this is what we want, when they meet with their delegation, which I assume they still do regularly, she is able to articulate our position and our opinion. And if they don't do it, women change elections. We vote more than any other demographic. African American women, we get that thing turned out. So don't ever applaud. So let's not underestimate the power of our vote. So I'm glad to be here and I'm glad that you came out today. That's it.
I'm Scarlett Burgess, and I apologize for being late. I had put it in my phone, it was 3 o'clock, and it said a reminder, and I was just lollygagging about the house. The reason I'm here is because I have four daughters, 35, 32, 14, and 11, and I have my 14-year-old and my 11-year-old with me today. Whenever I was at work and I got the alert on my phone that there had been another shooting, I sat at my desk and I literally cried. I just cried. And Columbine took place in 1999, and that was 15 deaths, including two shooters. There have been 25 shootings since then. My oldest daughter was a junior in high school in Columbine, and now she has made me the grandmother of two sons. Nothing has changed. Laws have not changed. Nothing has changed. At Sandy Hook, 26 kids, or actually it was 26 total, 20 children, 6 adults died. Nothing changed. Nothing changed. Nothing changed. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm fed up. I have got a belly full, and I am done. I'm going to talk. I'm going to shout. I'm going to call. I'm going to write. I'm going to vote. I'm going to be there. Everybody's going to be. We're not safe in America. And I'm a gun owner. I'm not going to pretend support guns, I support the Second Amendment. However, our lawmakers are bought and paid for by the NRA.
Indeed.
And just this week, we saw some progress. President Trump is talking about enhanced background checks, assault and rifles. He had one meeting with the NRA and came out and said, we don't need that. So the tools that, and this was a post I saw on Facebook, guns are just tools. They're just tools, like a spoon or a fork or a hammer. It's just a tool. And I would say to that, I don't have any tools around my house that I use just to kill somebody. Mm-hmm. And that's what guns are made for. That tool is made to create death in either an animal or a human being. So gun-related deaths are the third leading cause of child death in America. I didn't know that. I was researching this in gun laws, gun control, etc. The third leading cause of our children's deaths are guns. Either from here, you see it on Facebook and social media, on the news, a little guy gets a hold of a gun and shoots his friend, shoots his sister, and nothing's being done. Nothing's changing. I'm tired of this. I want change. Some of the things that I propose to change is limit magazines to 10 bullets or less. That's not going to stop deaths, but you won't have 17. Standardized background checks across state lines. At this point, when a person goes in to buy a gun, they do a background check, and if there's a flag on it, it takes 3 days for the FBI to get back to them. However, they can take the gun home. I don't want that to happen anymore. I want to see guns treated like cars. I want them licensed, I want them regulated, and I want mandatory insurance on them. Mm-hmm. Mandatory. If you get a gun, you gotta have liability insurance in case your child shoots somebody. Mm-hmm. I want to allow the CDC to collect data about gun violence.
Yes.
They no longer do that. So we don't even know really how many people are dying from guns. We don't know that because it's a big secret thing.
It can be funded.
Yes, it needs to be funded. I want to raise the age to 21 for any guns. If you buy a gun, you got to be 21 years old. I want to close the gun show loophole.
Yes.
Right now, you can go to a gun dealer and they say, oh no, you're crazy. You cannot have a gun. You have a mental illness. You have this, you have that. We're not going to sell you a gun. Well, you can go to one of these big gun shows like they have in Raleigh all the time and buy a gun from a private dealer and no one knows. And now you're a person who's a danger to society. You have several criminals, you may be a felon, etc. Now you have a gun in your hands. One of my favorite comedians, I'm going to close up with this. Chris Rock said, you don't need gun control. What you need is bullet control. He said, tax those bullets, make them $5,000 a piece, and then the gun violence will stop.
Why can we not regulate things? Now, it's been a long time since I've it's not rocket science. This is stuff that we already have in place. We just have to find the similarities and bring things together.
Does that mic work?
I'm sorry?
Does that mic work?
I couldn't get it to work. I'm an ex-cheerleader, so I can holler pretty loud. I'm the mother of four boys. I can talk pretty loud.
Thank you so much for coming in this beautiful afternoon. I'm Dr. Aziz. And we started this group after the Florida shooting, but this is not going to be just for shooting. It is going to be an ongoing group, ongoing event, so that we can ensure safety of our kids in school. I'm a physician by profession. So I like to treat a condition or any disease or anything which kills patients or kills human beings with some data. So when it is a preventable death, we always find out why or how this happened and what can we do to prevent it. So all of us agree that gunshot wound is a preventable death, okay? So in 1993, CDC had a department which was for preventing the injuries. It was CDC, which is the Central Disease Control, had a Center for Injury Prevention. And that funded a study which came in New England Journal of Medicine, which is a very reputable medical journal, in 1993. And the study said that if you have a gun at home, the chances of getting homicide or suicide is much more than if you don't have a gun. So in order for you to be safe at home, right, keeping the guns for safety was not really that important, because when the gun was home, rather than you being safe, you were more liable to get homicide or suicide by accident or by for any other reason. Now, when this study came out, just like now we are all getting together, so many media outlets are here talking about it, there was a huge debate about it. And when this was a huge debate about it, people started thinking, right, you know what? Probably this is true. And it was backed by data. National Rifle Association came up and demanded that we stop funding to CDC injury control. And our lawmakers succumbed to that. And in 1996, our Congressman Jay Dickey from Arkansas, he sponsored an amendment in which the funding for CDC for disease control because of guns was stopped, was altered. And up to this date, it has not come back. So, many, many years later, Congressman Dickey, he passed last year. In 2020, and he regretted. He regretted this decision. So that is what I'm coming to. You know, we can have high emotions, Democrat versus Republicans. We can say, they're taking my guns out. They're saying, oh, no, 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 we only want gun safety. This group is not about Democrats or Republicans. This group is the mom's group and the safety of our kids in school. We don't care whether you're a Democrat or a Republican. The bullet is not going to discriminate the child of a Democrat and the child of a Republican. Will take the life of our child, and the kid is our kid, everyone's kid. So he, in 2012, and to be honest, what happened was that Rosenberg, who was the CDC director at the time, he said in 1994, he said that we should treat guns as cigarettes. Cigarettes at one time was sexy, was macho. Everybody wanted it. It looked, you know, glamorous. But now it is dirty. It is dumb. The perception. when he said that, he was transferred from his CDC department to some other department. He was not the right person because he was talking about against us. And NRA is very, very powerful. NRA is the one who is ruling all of us because he has bought all of our representatives. We only vote and then go and sign laws for them. So as a physician, I talk about things which are common, preventable diseases, preventable causes of death, okay? So one was HIV. In 1992, when I started my residency in Michigan, I still remember a 21-year-old guy, African-American, I will call him Brandon, just for his privacy. My senior resident was Lila, and the first day when I went to, it was a regular ward, it was not ICU. We went and this guy was 21-year-old, lying in bed and with HIV. And he was admitted with PCP pneumonia, and the physicians over here would understand that it is an opportunistic infection which can happen to HIV patients. At the time, when you had HIV, it was as if it was a death sentence. And Dr. Phillips would agree with that. We really didn't have enough data how to take care of HIV at that time. This guy was being always laughing, and while laughing, he would just start crying. And Lela and I would cry with him because we knew he was going to die. Few days later, I actually responded to a code. We really couldn't save Brandon. But 20 years later, we are saving a lot of Brandons now. Because now we know what HIV is about. We have collected data about it. We know that these are the opportunistic infections. This is the prophylaxis we have to give. These are the medications. These are the combination of medications which have to be given at this time, at this time, or this time. At this stage, at this stage, at this stage. But we cannot collect data for guns laws or gun safety because NRA is preventing us from doing so. I would come up with auto accidents. Auto accidents are a big part. There was a lot of accidents and deaths, which is a preventable death. So we came up with the auto preventive laws. We came up with a seatbelt. We came up with the airbags. We came up with the whole new designs of the car. We came up with the new designs of the roads. Drunk driving, so many laws came up for against drunk driving because the data was there. And even now when there is an accident, even to the minute level, we have to tell how the accident happened because it all comes in the form of data. But we together here today to demand that enough is enough. This shooting should be the last shooting of in our country. This is the last shooting. Because anyone who is going to succumb to NRA now has to go out. 1993 and 2018 is a long time. If our lawmakers want to be bossed by NRA, then they won't have our vote. We will look at the campaign funding of all our lawmakers and we will find out who is their actual boss.
Yes.
We will find out who is their actual boss and then we will research that actual boss and we will vote that person out. And this is going to be the power of mothers. Because when it comes to our kids, no one can stop us. This is when we are going to make history, that this is going to be the last shooting of school. Because we will make sure that this happens. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Now we have and both of them sit on the task force of school safety. And we will hold them accountable. And you will also listen to them and see how they are working. So, Marvin, Lucas, please Give him a hand of applause.
Thank you, Dr. Aziz, and happy to see so many of you, especially women, who are present here this afternoon. I wish that you brought your husbands. We have Mr. Maple, Mr. Marble, and a couple of others, but you know, and I'm happy that you indicated that you want to challenge those who've been bought by the NRA. I can assure you that I've not been bought. I've not received one dime from the NRA. I am a gun advocate. I'm an avid hunter. I have several guns in my house, but I've never shot an individual or human being. I never intend to shoot one. My dad had guns. My son has guns. My grandsons have guns. But they won't shoot anybody either. They're too involved in academia to be involved in that kind of nonsense. But I will submit to you that if we're going to truly make a change as it relates to this matter of gun safety and violence, we've got to engage the male gender. Think about that. Go from Columbine to Newtown to Florida to the theater, Colorado, any place you want to go. Who did that shooting? All disgruntled males. Disgruntled males. So we've got to work on those guys. I haven't seen any females doing any shooting like that. Why is that? We've got to engage those who will be willing to assist us in accomplishing our mission. Right now, we've got a grassroots campaign going, and please excuse me, reality season is killing me. But we've got some youth right now, ages 16 to about 19, and they are really involved. High school students all over this nation, we've got to not let that die. We can't afford to let that die. If you have to empower them with money, with support, whatever we've got to do, we've got an election coming up in November. Let's help them. Many of them will be eligible to vote in November. Let's continue to empower them. They can influence their dads and their uncles and their aunts and those who are inclined. And when I say aunts, most of that's scare tactic. People who have guns to shoot individuals engage in scare tactics. And it's sponsored by lots of times the NRA. They're going to break into your house. They're going to rape you. You need guns. They tell you that all the time. It's propaganda. And as you indicated, most of you have indicated, many of our legislators are bought by the NRA. Do you know how much money the President of the United States received in his last campaign from NRA? $11 million. $11 million. Look at our state legislators, the House and Senate. Those who are in leadership positions have been bought by the NRA. Why are they putting that money there? Because they know that they can buy influence. How do you stop that? Cut it off at the source. We've begun to do some of that now. We've identified many of these contributors to the NRA. Delta Airlines has decided they're going to pull back. But they've been challenged down in Georgia, the headquarters down in Atlanta, and they've been threatened by legislators in Georgia.
Yes, sir.
We'll cut off your airline.
So
threats are going both ways, but we need to not allow them to get away with that. Many of those folks who are fueling the NRA are doing that with the corporations. Let's get tough on these corporations who are funding them. If they don't have any money, they can't influence anybody. And they're afraid to death of that. They don't like those who talk against them. And that's why they don't like me, even though I hunt and have guns. They told me in 08 why would they treat me that in a way that they'll never, ever support me? Because they told me, and I'll tell you why they told me that. They told me that I supported the wrong person, the President of the United States. That's a fact. Look it up. NRA needs to be challenged. They, oh, we'll go back to this, well, the Second Amendment. Have you ever heard that? They're trying to deny our Second Amendment rights.
Yes.
That's not true. That is not true. The Second Amendment can remain intact, and we can still have a well-maintained militia. That's what the Second Amendment addresses, a well-maintained militia. Don't we have the strongest armed forces in the United, anywhere in the world?
Yes.
We think we do, and I know we do. So how is our militia in danger? That's what I call a bird trap. Don't allow them to fool you with that. We will always maintain a well-maintained militia. Now, why do they need an AR-15? I've never used one. I don't know one. Never will buy one. You don't need one. You can't use it. Do you know what the regulations are if you're shooting migratory birds? Does anybody have an idea? The wildlife does. 3 shots. That's all you're allowed to get. So if you can only shoot a bird with 3, why do you have to shoot a human with 45? Makes no sense.
You know why just for deer in some states?
Yeah.
Six.
Six, yes. Even now, shotgun won't hold but 6. If it holds more than 6, you're going to get a ticket.
Yes.
You're going to get a ticket. I put it on Dr. Zeke's farm. I don't need 400 rounds of ammunition. It's inhumane. It's inhumane, some people say anyway. But the idea is that you're being fooled into thinking, and I'm going to shut up a minute, but I just have to get on this soapbox because it's all wrong. It's politically designed through scare tactics. The NRA is not your friend. Remember that. So whenever folk tell you that I have to maintain my membership in the NRA, that's fine. I don't have a problem with anybody being in the NRA, but don't let them fool you into thinking that you are a coward when it comes to gun safety. You're not. You're not a coward. And we've got to use that kind of philosophy if we're going to change this. Because you're not going to ever change those legislators who are involved unless you drive them up. Don't deceive yourself. They are not going to change. The president even tells you what you want to hear one day, and the next day, oh, I'll back off because they already didn't like that. And that's what's going to happen. What's happened every time we had a mass shooting in the schools? We get all riled up for 2 or 3 weeks, and then it's right back to the status quo. And then you have another shooting. Why can't we in the schools use the monitoring system among our peers? Student peers, I call school, I know. Students will tell you when there's something going on if they have a report with you. Old Johnny over there is going to have a fight with school when he comes in. Let's identify these potential dangerous students and let's make sure that we have good psychologists in the school. Let's make sure that we know what's going on in the homes, that these guns are not available. Guys purchase an AR-15. Everybody ought to know it. It ought to be a national neon sign. Marvin Lucas has an AR-15. Everybody knows that. Then we can monitor it much better. There's no need in having a 19-year-old with a mental problem sneaking into a school with an AR-15. And please don't tell me we need to arm teachers. Please don't tell me that. No way. That will never be a deterrent, because you know what happens when the real thing occurs? Whenever there's a real catastrophic circumstance, kids panic. If you've got a teacher there with a gun and kids are running everywhere trying to escape, that teacher's going to shoot some innocent students. Then you've got another major problem. A teachers, we should not be in this institution.
Lawsuits.
Lawsuits? Out of the yang yang. Don't be deceived. Let's do what we need to do. Let's stand up and be citizens of this United States, and let's employ actual gun safety. It can be done. We must do it.
Really good, because it allows those naysayers an opportunity. state and what is coming out of that legislation. Now, legislation is going to come up for, I think you have 3,000 teachers in Cumberland County?
A little bit more than that.
Okay, so we just use 3,000. That's 3,000 guns. And the only person going to benefit from that is the gun seller,
yes,
which is a member of
the NRA.
Okay, they're going to benefit from, you know, from that. And to think about it, some of our teachers are using their own personal money to provide and assist in education learning of our kids. So that is another stress and strain. And then on top of that, you're going to say, we want you to teach you, but at the same time, we want you to police. And you have some students in the school that say, Reverend Citizen Lucas is wearing his gun today. We don't have to bring one. We'll just manhandle Representative Lucas and take his gun. Just the other day, I think it was a teacher that shot through the window. Now that was a teacher that did this. So we have some concerns as it relates to safety within our school. And by the way, I look at my campaign, and you can go there, and I can assist you before you. You look at it, I haven't gotten a contribution from NRA. If you're a Democrat, I'd like that you will get one. So, you know, you can save those two, look at the other 118 out there. But we have we really have a concern as it relates to the statutes that sort of allow individuals to purchase guns, and many of them have very little training. When you see the type of weapons that are being sold, they're what we call in the military assault weapons.
Yes.
They're used for mass destruction. That's what they're used for. That's what they're used for. I mean, when you go, you intend to leave the person there. You're not going there to shake his hand or her hand. You're going to make sure that you meet the task at hand, is to clear the whole area by shooting everything that looked like it might lose. So I want to thank you for the opportunity to talk with you, to share with you that we do have a concern. And again, the first line are those committee members.
And I was going to ask you, how often does that committee meet? Is that on the website? We can go in the legislation website and look up the committee for it.
My understanding is that they have not called a meeting as of yet, but most meetings are called by 9 o'clock the day before. The question of it is, what would the agenda look like?
Right.
You know, so normally it's that you would have to keep looking at the website. And then if it does come, they usually meet a week after the public notice is out. Mm-hmm. They would meet proper a week following that, so it would give the public an opportunity to know whether or not they want to come. And also, once they see the agenda, then they can request that they have, time to speak. And if not, you know, Representative Lucas and I, we're on the committee, we would approach the chair and ask the chair to set aside time to allow those individuals to speak. And they may have 1 to 2 minutes, and you have a person sitting down front that let you know when you're 1 to 2 minutes.
Excuse me, may I object this, but this would be the second committee on safe schools, and I don't want to muddy the water, but there has been a committee in force for the last 3 years. It's the Governor's Commission on Safe Schools, and it was implemented right after Sandy Hook. Now, I don't know what the legislative committee is going to look like, or if it's going to be a duplication of what we've been doing with the Governor's Task Force on school safety. This has been headed by Chief Justice Mark Markey, and we've been meeting about 3 times a year.
I have a question for both of you. As I understand, that federal government has basic minimum rules of gun safety, and each state can tweak those rules the way the state wants to tweak it. So some of the states have very strict gun laws, and other states don't have that strict gun laws. As I understand, this young man who came and shot 17 kids, innocent kids, he got that rifle from a firearm dealership. And the rules and regulations of firearm dealerships are not the same as a gun dealership. So for federal government says that if you want to own a handgun, you have to be 21 years old. But if you want to go and get a firearm, you can get it at 18 years of age. So this guy actually, even if he had had the background check, the kids were talking, but he did not have any law enforcement problem. So if he had a background check, he would have passed that background check. He did look in, he was not fitting into any profile. He was not like an African American, he was not a Middle Eastern, he was a white kid. So he would not have come up into any profile either. And he was able to, even though he was mentally ill, he was able to have his hands on these assault weapons from firearm dealership, which is different from like otherwise getting a handgun. So what are our plans in the General Assembly to
That's a loophole that we need to close. Florida should have already closed that loophole. That's what I mean by cooperation within the school system. This kid had, I think, about this 30-some-odd run-ins prior to purchasing that gun. He shouldn't have had a gun. He'd had mental problems that had been documented, and nobody followed up on it. We've got to fix the flaws and the loopholes in the system. Kids have been caught a long time ago.
Can I add something, too? As the wife of a former cop, I asked my husband, how much do these semi-automatic weapons cost? And he said, well, you know, you could probably get one maybe for $450, but the one that was used in Florida was about $1,000. Now, how does a 19-year-old kid get $1,000 to get a weapon like this? Or get multiple ones? The guy out in Las Vegas that shot the people at the music festival, he had a whole arsenal of things. We should look to see how they're paying for them. You shouldn't be able to get it on a credit card and put it on payments and walk out of the thing without putting at least cash money down. I mean, I'm not saying that you can't pay cash money, but let's not just let them walk on out without some kind of evaluation or somebody saying, hey, wait a second, sir, you've bought 3 guns in the past 3 weeks. What are you doing? Okay? I mean, there are things that we can kind of bring together. And again, I'm extrapolating from what we have as physicians and some of the things that the legislature has told us that we can and cannot do.
So I have a quick question for both of our representatives. Sylvia Lofgren from Fayetteville, educator, 20-plus years administrator, and education advocate. So my question for either of you, the school safety task force that you gentlemen are referring to, has there been any conversation with either of you personally, with any of our pro-education nonpartisan organizations across the state of North Carolina yet? And if not, will there be any conversation moving forward to have those people at those committee meetings to hear the voice of the educator, to hear the voice of the teacher, to hear the voice of pro-education advocates to help you with your work?
I'm sure they will.
Okay. So we're just looking for it. We're just waiting for it.
I didn't hear your response.
I'm sure that they will. Yes.
Amber, is there any way that we can get a list of the names of the 45 people on that committee?
Yes.
That's good.
Yes.
If you go to the General Assembly website and look at public safety, you will see all of our names up there.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, yes.
It's on the website. Okay. You know, that committee is a non-standing committee, so you will have to look. And that committee would probably will say, for instance, we go back on May 12th.
Mm-hmm.
So that committee would probably be reporting back in the long session about suggestions and recommendation of that.
And in the interest of full disclosure, don't be surprised if my name is extrapolated from that list, because I've been quite vocal about what we need to do, and I'm not so sure that the leadership is interested in my concepts of what we need to do. So, just be prepared.
Well, Representative Lucas, when you say the leadership of that standing committee or the leadership in our General Assembly?
The leadership in the General Assembly.
Okay. And I know exactly. Okay, gotcha.
There are two.
Just need a clarification.
Involved.
Thank you.
Okay, so let me say to you, I don't have a friend at breaking cars. I would then use that as an example about how people get guns because they know that you lock them up in the glove compartment. So they don't go to the trunk. You can go to the glove compartment. That's how it's statute. So thank you so much for the opportunity to share these